الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا متقبلا يا أرحم الراحمين. Oh Allah, teach us what benefit us. Increase us in knowledge, in good morals and in good deeds يا رب العالمين. We start this class seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help, learning the Qiraat of Ibn Amir al-Shami, rahimahullah ta'ala. Imam Ibn Amir al-Shami, one of the seven Qurra, or of the ten Qurra, that the Ummah agreed on their Qiraat, and who passed the Qiraat to us from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until our time. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who blessed us to fulfill this communal obligation of passing these qira'at. We pray to him subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us recite the book, recite his book in the way that pleases him, and to teach it to others and to understand it and to act upon it. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. We're going to start with that. The main reference in this class will be the qira'ah I read to my Shaykh, His Eminence Shaykh Bakri al-Tarabishi, rahimahullah ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me that I read to him Ibn Amir al-Shami and Asim al-Kufi. Ibn Amir al-Shami with his two narrators and Asim al-Kufi with his two narrators, Hafs and Shu'ba. And Ibn Amir's narrators are Hisham and Ibn Dakwan. Another reference, the book that we're going to use is by Sheikh Tawfiq Damra. I'm going to share it with you in the group, inshallah. It's called Zadu al-Sair ila Qira'at ibn Amir bi riwayatay Hisham wa bin Dhakwan. And also the book At-Tasheel by Sheikh Fahd Kharouf, which has the 10 Qira'at on the margin of the Mus'haf. The 10 Qira'at, and this is the Mus'haf that our Shaykh used to follow with, to follow from when he used to listen to his students. At-Tasheel. These are the references, inshallah. So we're going to start quickly with an introduction on the Qira'at. Or before that, we're going to go from the book itself. We're going to start from the book itself. And this book, or this Sheikh, Sheikh Tawfiq Bamra, he's certified and licensed in the 10 Qira'at from many Sheikhs. And he read to our Sheikh, Sheikh Bakri, rahimahullah ta'ala, he read some of the Qur'an, not all of it, but the Sheikh gave him ijazah in the other Qira'at. So, Zadu al-Sair ila Qira'at ibn Amir. Zad al-Sair ila Qira'at ibn Amir. Zad is like the provision or what you take with you in your journey. Al-Sair, the walker, the one who's like walking or traveling. Ila Qira'at ibn Amir bi riwayatay Hisham wa bin Dhakwan min tariq al-Shatibiyyah. So we're going to learn only al-Shatibiyyah way because that's the way I learned. But the Sheikh, he added also some differences between al-Shatibiyyah and al-Tayyibah way. Dr. I'adad, prepared by Dr. Tawfiq Ibrahim Damra. He's a Tajweed and Qira'at teacher in Al-Masjid Al-Husayni, the Grand Husayni Masjid in Amman in Jordan. And he's certified or licensed in the 10 minor and major Qira'at, or Qira'at Sughra and Al-Kubra. We're going to read the introduction of Sheikh Bakri Tarabishi, rahimahullah ta'ala. He made a foreword for this book. And then we're going to talk about Imam Ibn Amir a little bit, and Imam Hisham and Ammar, Hisham bin Ammar and Ibn Dakwan. And next week, inshallah, we start with the usul, or the foundations of this qira'ah, which differs from, or in which Imam Ibn Amir differs from Imam Asim, or particularly, Hafs, or Imam Asim in general. So we're going to learn the usul first, the main rules in which Imam Ibn Amir differs from Imam Asim in his qira'ah. And after we finish those usul, and they're not a lot, and that's why many of the students, they combine, many of the students, they combine the qira'ah of Ibn Amir with Asim, because they're close, they're very close. There isn't big differences. Unlike, for example, Warsh, which will be, inshallah, if Allah wills, the next riwayah that I will teach, inshallah, if Allah wills, maybe in a year or so. So, Imam, or our Sheikh, Sheikh Bakri Tarabishi, may Allah bless him, shower him with his mercy and blessings, and raise his ranks, and bring us with him under the banner of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I read to him this qira'ah along with Asim. So I read them together in one khatma. So I would read Hisham and Ibn Dakwan and then Shu'ba and then Hafs. So that's the order you read these two qira'at. So any word when you're reading, any word, any two qira'ah who agree on a certain ayah or a certain word, they're combined, and then you read those who differ. You read only the parts that are different. Our Sheikh says, Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. So he started with this blessed ayah from Surah Al-Kahf. Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا. So all praise and thanks be to Allah who revealed the book to his servant, and he did not make any crookedness in it. It is upright and straight, so that it warns a severe punishment from him, and to give the glad tidings or the happy news to the believers who do righteous deeds or who do good deeds, that they will get a great reward. وَالصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ الَّذِي سَأَلَ التَّخْفِيفَ عَنْ أُمَّتِهِ فِي قِرَاءَةِ الْقُرْآنِ. And salawat and salam ala Sayyidina Muhammad means may Allah raise the position and shower with more blessings our beloved Muhammad, our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Prophet Muhammad. الَّذِي سَأَلَ التَّخْفِيفَ عَنْ أُمَّتِي, who asked for تَخْفِيف for his ummah, who asked في قراءة القرآن, who asked Allah through Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam to make it light on his ummah in the recitation of the Qur'an. Means he asked for more flexibility in the recitation of the Qur'an, for more variety in the readings or the ways of reading the Qur'an. As in the hadith of Sayyidina Ubay bin Ka'b radiyallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Jibreel, O Jibreel, I was sent to an ummah that is illiterate or unlearned. Minhum al-ajuz, among them the old women, wa sheikh and the old man, wa al-ghulam and some little ones, and a person who might have not read a book at all, means people who are not all educated in reading and writing. So he said, Ya Muhammad, inna al-Qur'an unzil ala sab'ati ahruf. He said, Oh Muhammad, the Qur'an has been revealed on 7 ahruf. And we will remind you a little bit about those 7 ahruf. Warda Allahumma an sahbihi ajma'in. الذين تلقوا القرآن الكريم من فم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Allah be pleased with all of his companions who received the Holy Quran from the mouth of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم with the al-ahruf sab'a, with the 7 ahruf. 7 ahruf are 7 categories of differences in the qira'at, in the readings of the Quran. These are different from the 7 qira'at. Different from the 7 qira'at. Al-ahruf al-sab'a, the 7 ahruf, are 7 categories of differences in the recitation of the Qur'an. The result of those 7 ahruf is the 10 qira'at that we have today. The 10 qira'at that we have today. So if you look at the qira'at of the Quran that we have today, and you try to categorize the differences in those qira'at, they'll be in 7 categories. Okay? And those 7 categories, we mentioned them in details, like change in the verb, change in the dialect, change in the addition or deletion, etc. And those qira'at, since we talked about the qira'at of the Quran, we can summarize them in 2 categories of differences. 2. If we want to make major differences, they are only 2 categories of differences. The first one, which is the most spread in the Quran, is the dialects. Some words in the Quran, they are read with more than one dialect. And from this difference, it's clear that the purpose is what, ya Sheikh Muhammad? To make it easy for the Ummah, right? The Arabs in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were in so many tribes and they have different dialects. Like now, you know, the Arabs, they have many dialects, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran with those types of dialects or differences. Now, this is one category. Some people and some sheikhs, unfortunately, they come and they say that the qira'at is only about dialects, and that's absolutely not right. So dialects are part of the differences in the qira'at. The other part is different words, not only dialects, different words, sometimes synonyms and sometimes not. And those different words, they were revealed to give variety and richness in the meanings of the Holy Quran. And I'm not going to go into more details on the qira'at. You can go to Al-Jazariya new course, Al-Jazariya Made Easy, the new course. I explained in details about it. And you can also go to the Quranic Talk series. I also talked about it in some details. So we continue the introduction of our Sheikh, Sheikh Bakri, may Allah have mercy on him. So he said, O Allah, be pleased with his companion, all of his companions who received the Quran from the mouth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the 7 ahruf and taught it to the tabi'een, taught it to their followers, to their students as they heard them. And they said, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam commands you to read the Quran as you were taught. And may Allah be pleased with the Rabbani scholars, the great devout scholars who read the Quran and taught it and wrote the books and explained and detailed the narrations. And they said, Al-qira'atu sunnatul muttaba'a ya'khuduha al-akhiru anil awwal. I explained in details about how the Quran was passed down to us from generation to generation in Al-Jazariya Made Easy class. So I'm not going to go into that. One of the main rules and one of the main statements that the scholars of Quran always mention, that recitation of the Quran is a sunnah muttaba'a, is a way that has to be followed, is a way in which the later takes from the former, the later or the latter, takes from the former, the one who comes later takes from the one who was before. So you cannot take it, you can never, ever, ever make analogies in the recitation. You can never, ever innovate a new practice or way of recitation in any way. And he said, they received the Quran with the 7 ahruf and taught it to their students. So all of the 7 ahruf are preserved, and we read with them. We read with those 7 ahruf. And the opinion that says Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu abrogated some of the ahruf and kept only one harf, that opinion is rejected, is invalid, because history doesn't support it, and the qira'at, the 10 qira'at themselves, never supports that opinion. So keep that in your mind, because it's common among some teachers and some websites. Amma ba'd, then Sheikh Bakri, may Allah have mercy on him, he says, Amma ba'd, to begin with, since Abu Bakr bin Mujahid wrote his book, which is called As-Sab'ah, in the Qira'at, the scholars still writing about the Qira'at, and some of them added on the 7 Qira'at. So some of the scholars wrote in the collected 8 Qira'at, and some of them 10, and some of them 50 Qira'at, as Imam Al-Hudhari in his Al-Kamil. He collected 50 of the Qira'at, 50. But not all of the Qira'at are mutawatir, not all of the Qira'at are accepted. That's why the scholars of the Quran, they agreed on those 10 Qira'at, because they were mutawatir. They fulfilled all the conditions of the accepted Qira'ah. They were narrated to us through a big number of reciters, to a big number, to a big number, in a way that is impossible to have any mistake in them. وَمِنَ الْعُلَمَاءِ مَنْ كَتَبَ فِي أَقَلْ, and some scholars wrote less than that. Some scholars made separate books, one book for a certain qira'ah only. And then he says, Sheikh Tawfiq Damra brought to me this book and some other books, since I'm the closest of people to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in regard with the sanad, in regard with the chains of the narrators of the Holy Quran. Sheikh Bakri, in his time, may Allah have mercy on him, he was the nearest or the closest to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. With how many narrators, Yahana, from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Sheikh Bakri?
Was it 28?
27. So from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, between the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Sheikh Bakri, they were 27. And Allah blessed us to have a 28. And then Allah blessed you, ya Sister Hannah, to have a 29. So, and Sheikh Bakri had not only in Hafiz, or no, he had in the 7 Qira'at, in the 7 Qira'at from the Shatibiyya way. He said, I found this book with an easy, made in an easy way, and mentioned the foundations or the rules of the Qira'ah of Ibn Amir, in which he differs from Hafs. And he mentioned the words in every surah. So the way Sheikh Tawfiq does all of his books is he mentions the usul of the Qira'ah first, the foundations, the rules of the Qira'ah of Ibn Amir, in which he differs from Hafs. Tamam. And then he mentions every surah. He goes surah by surah. He mentions the words that are different in that surah. And you will see the differences sometimes are very little, very little. But if you come to Shu'bah, as we studied Shu'bah before, Shu'bah, the difference is even less. Why? Because Hafs and Shu'bah, they are one qira'ah. One qira'ah. So they have the same foundations, but they're little differences. Here, Ibn Amir is a different qira'ah. So there'll be a little bit more differences than the differences between Hafs and Shu'bah, but they are still very close to that qira'ah. And inshallah, I'm going to share the book with you so that you look at the words, and every one of you will recite those differences. Otherwise, there is no benefit of this class. The main benefit of this class for you as students who are seeking to learn this qira'ah is to read those differences so that you are ready to recite them to me or to a sheikh who's license in this qira'ah, inshallah. So he says, and look, and this is why I wanted to read this introduction to you guys from Sheikh Bakri rahimahullah ta'ala. He says, with noticing that the seeker, and that's what I just mentioned, that the seeker of knowledge must sit in the circles of knowledge to receive the Holy Quran orally. face to face from the mouth of the perfecting or perfection, perfection, perfecting or perfect scholars who are connected with the chains, so that he connects his chain with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or so he that a connected, so he that he has a connected chain with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he said, "Well, isnad, these are chains that connect us with our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not only in the Holy Quran but in Hadith also, and in Fiqh, in the all of the fields of the Islamic knowledge, all the disciplines of the Islamic knowledge. This isnad is min khasa'isi hadhihi al-umma, is of the special qualities or features or characteristics of this ummah, of the Muslim community. You don't find this in any community, in any religion. You don't find it. Now, you don't find a person who knows the Bible by heart, for example. You don't find. But you find millions of Muslims who knows the Quran by heart, and millions of kids and young ones and old ones. But you, and not only they memorized it by heart, they have connected chains. They read it to, they did not like just learn it from the book. No, they learned it orally, and they read it to scholars who read it to scholars who read it to scholars back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And those chains, we have thousands and thousands of those chains from different countries, different nationalities, different languages, but they all read the same text in the Arabic language in which the Holy Quran was revealed. This is the great, great blessing from Allah, because Allah promised, subhanahu wa ta'ala, he promised he will preserve the Quran, and this is the way he preserved it. So it's all his blessing, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said, al-isnad min khasa'isi hadhihi al-umma. This isnad, this way of preserving the religion, is from the special qualities of this ummah. And may Allah have mercy on Ibn al-Mubarak, one of the great tabi'een, when he said, al-isnad min ad-deen. This isnad is a great part of the religion. Tanafasa ulama al-salaf fi talabi ulu al-isnad. The scholars of the salaf, our righteous predecessors, they were competing with one another to seek the high sanad. What does high sanad mean? Means to get a shorter chain between you and the source of the Quran, means the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who received the Quran from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through angel Jibreel alayhi salam. So they used to compete in getting a high sanad, a high sanad. Sheikh Ayman Suwaid, rahimahullah ta'ala, he comments on this issue in one of his lectures about al-isnad. He says, rahimahullah ta'ala, that some people nowadays, they go to some old sheikhs, they're very old, and they're, when you're reading to them, they sometimes sleep when you're reading to them. But these students, they're not like very qualified. They're like, they're just learning, and they want to go to those old sheikhs so that they get an ijazah with high sanad. So the sheikh is saying, yani, don't deceive yourself. Okay, you need to go to a younger sheikh who can help you improve your reading and fix your mistakes. But you don't go to one of those old sheikhs who sometimes he's not fully awake or paying attention to you when you're reading to him because of his old age, but he doesn't want to stop teaching people. Subhanallah. You don't go to those sheikhs and then you say, I got a very high sanad and your reading is not good. So we have to pay attention to this issue. Our Sheikh Bakri, may Allah have mercy on him, I never ever saw him like closing his eyes when he was teaching us, even though he was old, but he died later. But alhamdulillah, I never saw him closing an eye. And he was always looking at the Mus'haf, and he would read with us. He would move his lips and reading while he was listening to us and looking at his Mus'haf, which is, as I told you, at Tasheel, which will also be one of our references in this class, inshallah. So we pay attention to this point, and people who might be hearing, who will be watching this class or this videos, I'm going to put some of those videos only, so that I encourage people to learn, inshallah. Learn from someone who is willing to teach and ready to teach and is able to teach you. Okay, don't only look at the high sanad. No. So he said, may Allah have mercy on them. They competed in seeking the high sanad, right? Sometimes they would travel. They learned something, let's say. They learned something from a sheikh in their country. And he's a great sheikh, and they learned this thing, this hadith or this qira'ah. Then they hear that in another country, there is a sheikh who teaches the same qira'ah, but he's closer to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the chains of narrators. So what does he do? He travels to read to that sheikh. And this way he has a shorter chain of narrators between him and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this means he had a higher sanad. He got a higher sanad. So he said, فَقَطَعُوا الْفَيَافِي. الْفَيَافِي, singular of الْفَيْف or الْفَيْفَات, which means a desert that has no water. وَالْقِفَار, plural of قِفَر, plural of قَفَر or قَفْرَة, which is also an empty land, also that usually doesn't have a lot of vegetation and water. وَمَخَرُوا عُبَابَ الْبِحَار, and they traveled in the sea. Al-ubab is the abundant water and the waves, and the that's al-ubab. Wa makharu ubab al-bihar means they traveled in the deserts, in the mountains, in the oceans, and connected the night with the day, walking, and so that they are raised even one generation or one level in their isnad or in their chains. And that's why Imam Ibn Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, طلب العلو في السند سنة عما سلف. Seeking to get the high sanad is a sunnah, is a way of the ways of the salaf, of our righteous predecessors. Then he says, وَنْفَضِّ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ, from Allah's blessings upon me that I received the seven qira'at from Shaykh of the Qurra in Shah, Muhammad Salim al-Hilwani, rahimahullah ta'ala, who was in the rank of Shaykh al-Mutawalli, who is the Shaykh of Qurra in Egypt in his time. I ask and call the students of knowledge to recite the Holy Quran with all of it, with its different or various narrations and recitations, and to understand it and to act upon it and to follow its morals, and that they don't forget me and Muslims from their good prayers and dua. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most Great, to benefit with this book, Islam and Muslims. كتبه مسند العصر الشيخ بكري بن الشيخ بن الشيخ عبد المجيد الطرابيشي. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on our Sheikh Bakri and all of our sheikhs and teachers who taught us. Then the Sheikh also has some other sheikhs who have some introductions or some forewords for to his book, and we're gonna skip that, and we're gonna go to the introduction of Imam Ibn Amir, or a little bit about Imam Ibn Amir, rahimahullah ta'ala. He mentions his way in the book. Then he starts about Ibn Amir, rahimahullah ta'ala. Who is Imam Ibn Amir? Before that, I'll read to you also something that, a hadith that I prepared about the qira'at. So the Sayyidina Ubay, we mentioned the hadith about Sayyidina Ubay, and I mentioned a lot of these hadith in the lectures I referred you to, in which I talked about the different qira'at. I'm going to mention one of them again here to show you the mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his love for us and for the ummah, and how the qira'at issue happened. Of course, it has been Allah's will always that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed and wanted to have the Quran, to reveal the Quran in more than one narration. But how that happened, when Sayyidina Ubay radiallahu anhu, he heard one of the Sahaba reading in a different way from his way. So he got very upset, and he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a long hadith, I mentioned this hadith in details in the Quranic Talk series and other series. Then he said, O Ubay, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explaining to Sayyidina Ubay. He said, O Ubay, it has been sent to me to read the Quran in one way, in one harf. Means without any differences, just in one way. فَرَدَتْتُ إِلَيْهِ I replied, and هَوِّنْ عَلَىٰ أُمَّتِي Make it easy for my ummah. Then he said, okay, read it in two ways. Means there will be two types of differences or two categories of differences. فَرَدَتْتُ إِلَيْهِ Then I said, make it easy for my ummah. Until he told him, read it in seven ways. فَرَدَّ إِلَيْهِ And the third time he told him, read it in seven ways. Means with, as we mentioned, the adopted opinion about these seven ahraf is that it is seven categories of differences. Then he said, وَلَكَ بِكُلِّ رَدَّةٍ رَدَدْتُكَهَا مَسْأَلَةٌ تَسْأَلُونِيهَا He said, with every question you asked me to make it easy for the ummah, Allah has given you a dua that will be answered. He said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, who's full of mercy and love for his ummah, what dua did he make? He said, اللهم اغفر لأمتي اللهم اغفر لأمتي صلى الله عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله And then he said وأخرت الثالثة ليوم يرغب إلي الخلق كلهم حتى إبراهيم And I delayed my third dua to a day in which all creatures will run to me or will seek my help including Ibrahim عليه السلام So that is the mercy and the love of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that shows the main purpose of the qira'at is what? Is what, ya Sheikh Muhammad? The main purpose of the differences in the qira'at is what? What's the main reason or wisdom? He said it sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Oh Allah, or he said, make it easy for my ummah. So it's to what? To make the recitation of the Quran what? Easy for the ummah, right, Sheikh? To make it easy for the ummah. Because as we mentioned, there were many tribes and not all of the tribes, they know the dialect of Quraysh, which is the tribe of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? And that's why until our day, you see in Morocco, in Algeria, in Tunisia, they read mostly in the narration of Imam Warsh from Nafi. In Sudan, they read in a different narration. In Sham, they read in a different... So until now, you see those narrations, they are spread in the Ummah. And many people find one narration easier than another. Subhanallah al-Azim. So that's one of the main reasons or wisdoms behind revealing the Quran in more than one narration. Some ignorant people who never learned, and they just maybe copy others, or they want to spread rumors about Islam or false concepts. They say, why Muslims are objecting on the different versions of the Bible? You also have different versions of the Quran. Look at this very poor, ignorant, wrong comparison. There's no comparison whatsoever between the different recitations or ways of recitation of the Holy Quran, which are all preserved through thousands of narrations, as we mentioned, and which never, ever in any single ayah or in any single way, never contradict. There will never, ever be, and you will never, ever find any contradiction in the meanings between any of the qira'at in the 10 qira'at. Ever, never. But when you come to the Bible, you find some chapters that exist in one Bible and doesn't exist in others. You find a change in the words that make big contradiction. You find additions of some full verses and even full chapters. What are you comparing? The Bible in many languages. The Bible is not preserved in the original language. The Bible has not been memorized. The Bible, etc., etc., etc. So there is no comparison whatsoever between these two things. So he also, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as in the other hadith, he said, Jibreel came to me and he said, Allah commands you to read the Quran to your ummah in one harf, on one harf. He said, أسأل الله معافاته ومغفرته. I ask Allah for his forgiveness and his to give us good, to give us well-being and to forgive us. My ummah cannot bear that. Look what the Prophet is saying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He came to him second time until he told him that you read the Quran in seven ahraf. Then he said, أَيُّمَا حَرْفٍ قَرَأُوا عَلَيْهِ فَقَدْ أَصَابُوا. In any harf they recite, they are correct. Of course, this means any harf that they received from you, they are right. These are the main hadith I wanted to share with you here. And then we come to Imam Ibn Amir, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Allah. Imam Ibn Amir al-Shami, rahimahullahu ta'ala. We have 5 more minutes. We can start, inshallah, an introduction about him. Imam al-Shatibi, rahimahullahu ta'ala, in his Shatibiyya, in which he collected the seven qira'at, which is 1,173 verses, when he talked about the Qur'an, he said, وَأَمَّا دِمَشْقُ الشَّامِ دَارُ بْنِ عَامِرٍ فَتِلْكَ بِعَبْدِ اللَّهِ طَابَتْ مُحَلَّلًا هِشَامٌ وَعَبْدُ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ انْتِسَابُهُ لِذَكْوَانَ بِالْإِسْنَادِ عَنْهُ تَنَقَّلًا. So he's saying, so he was mentioning the main cities of the Muslim world, and in each city he's mentioning the main Qurra. And then he gave everyone a symbol or a letter of the Arabic alphabet, so that during his poem, he will mention a certain word, and then he will put one of those letters or symbols of the alphabet to tell you that this word is read in this way by this qari or that qari. It's al-Shatibiyya, they say this is like a karama, like a miracle for Imam al-Shatibi, the way he formed it and the way he included the qira'at and the beauty of this poem. Subhanallah. May Allah have mercy on Imam al-Shatibi. So who's of course in those chains of narration, of narrators. So he's saying, as for Dimashq, Damascus of Asham, of the Levant, Dar ibn Amir, the place or the residence where Ibn Amir was. Fatilka bi abdillahi tabat, it has become good and fragrant with the residence of Imam Ibn Amir in it. Hisham and Abdullah wa huwa intisabuhu. Hisham and Abdullah wa huwa intisabuhu li Dhakwan. Hisham and Abdullah bin Dhakwan. They call him Ibn Dhakwan. Hisham and Ibn Dhakwan. Bil isnadi anhu tanakkala. They received the Quran from Imam Ibn Amir, but through mediums or narrators. So, and this might be very, this might be strange for some of you, or for many of you, that when we say Hafs an Asim, Hafs took directly from Imam Asim. Shu'ba an Asim, Shu'ba took directly from Imam Asim. But Hisham an Ibn Amir, Hisham has two narrators between him and Ibn Amir. The same with Ibn Dhakwan. Ibn Dhakwan, there are two narrators between him and Ibn Amir. He did not take directly from Ibn Amir. Then why they say Hisham from Ibn Amir? Because Hisham was of the distinguished. Hisham and Ibn Dhakwan, they were of the very distinguished students of who were distinguished in teaching the qira'ah of Imam Ibn Amir. Tamam? So that's what Imam al-Shatibi says here. Imam Ibn Amir, Abdullah Ibn Amir, his name is Abdullah, his kunya or title is Abu Imran. Abdullah Ibn Amir Ibn Yazid al-Yahsubi. And could be al-Yahsubi or al-Yahsubi, the scholars, they said three of them are right, but most famous is al-Yahsubi, al-Dimashqi from Damascus. And he and Abu Amr al-Basri are the only two qurra who are purely Arabs. Means they were pure Arabs. They were not like from they're all of their parents and fathers and grandfathers, they were from the Arab tribes. He was born 8 of the Hijrah. Means during the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, how old was he? Huh? How old was he? if he was born 8 of the Hijrah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away when? 10. So he was how many years old? 2 years old when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. Tabi'iyun jalil. So he met many of the Sahaba. Huh? Look at these narration or narrators that we have, guys. It's not like if you come to the Bible, there, as I said, there's no comparison. Those who wrote the Bible, many of them did not meet Sayyidina Isa, did not meet him at all, right? But we are narrating the Quran with connected chains, right? Like Luke. Who is Luke? In the Bible I have, it mentions who Luke was. He was a doctor, and the book says, the Bible that I have said, he was like a reporter, like a journalist who went to different places and took narrations from about and stories about Jesus alayhi salam. So there's no comparison, as I mentioned. Imam Ibn Amir, he is a tabi'i, he is a student of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. انتهت إليه مشيخة القراء في الشام. He was like the main grand مقرئ and قارئ in the Levant, in Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, Palestine, in that area. His symbol in the Shatibiyya is Kaf, and Hisham is Lam, and Ibn Dakwan is Mim. So Kalamun, then Nasa'un, Nasa', Nur for Asim, Sad for Shu'ba, and Ayn for Hafs. جمع بين الإمامة بالجامع الأموي بدمشق والقضاء ومشيخة الإقراء. So he was the Imam in the Umayyad, the Grand Umayyad Mosque, which is until now standing in Damascus. And he was a Qadi, he was the like a grand, he was like a justice, right? The big judge, they call him justice, right? And he was كان ناظرا على عمارتي حتى فرغ. And he was like supervisor on the building of the Umayyad Mosque until it was completed. أسن القراء, he was the oldest of the قراء. He among the other قراء, he was the oldest, means he lived, he was the oldest of all of them. He met سيدنا أبو الدرداء رضي الله عنه وأرضاه. سيدنا أبو الدرداء رضي الله عنه, the great صحابي, who was in the Umayyad Mosque in the Masjid of Dimashq, who رضي الله عنه وأرضاه, as Imam al-Dhahabi and others mention, Sayyidina Abu Darda kana idha salla al-ghadata, when he would pray Fajr in the Masjid of Damascus, ijtama'a an-nasu liqira'ati alayhi, people gather and come in tens of people come to read the Quran to him. What does he do? He cannot listen to all people, right? What did he do? He would make them in circles, 10, 10, 10, 10. And on every 10, he would put arif. He would put arif. In Sham, they call him arif. He would put arif, but I found it in the dictionary is arif. Arif or naqib. Arif is like a supervisor, like a teacher who's in charge of a circle or a class. And he would stand in the mihrab, the niche of the prayer, and he would be supervising them and looking at them. And if he hears one of them making a mistake, he would refer him to his teacher. And if he noticed the teacher makes a mistake, he would come and teach the teacher and remind the teacher. Or if one of those students, he makes a mistake, he returns to the teacher. And if one of those teachers has a mistake or doubts in something, he returns to Sayyidina Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, and he asks him about that. And Sayyidina Imam Ibn Amir al-Shami was one of those urafa, on those tens. And when he died, Sayyidina Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Ibn Amir, he was like his successor, and he would teach after him. So this, alhamdulillah, by Allah's blessings, we inherited this Quranic circle system that you find it now in so many countries of the world. And Allah blessed me, alhamdulillah, by Allah's blessings, by Allah's mercy, by Allah's help, that I have taught some of the students. And alhamdulillah, I used to put them in those types of circles or classes, and I would go and supervise them and serve them. It's absolutely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings. And this way, yani, this Shaykh, he teaches those smart students, those hardworking students who have the capability to teach, and then they will teach. But not, I cannot now, many people now contact me and they want me to teach their this kid and this kid and that kid. And of course, I cannot do that, right? So people should understand this, right? People should understand this. I refer them, alhamdulillah, now I have some students who are qualified and trustworthy, so I refer to them. So people have to be considerate and have to understand that leave those highly qualified sheikhs to teach teachers, to teach people who are willing to teach, and let them dedicate time to teach the teachers, so that this way the community will benefit more, they should understand this this concept, so that they don't feel like offended or feel sad that if those highly qualified teachers apologize and cannot teach their kids. It is said that he read some of the Quran or heard the Quran from Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, but we're not sure of that. But we are sure that he read to Sayyidina Abu Darda and to other Sahaba that we will mention them. He narrated some books. He narrated some ahadith radiallahu anhu arda Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amir. He narrated the hadith in Sahih Muslim and some other hadith books. So those sheikhs of Quran and qira'at, they're not only specialized in the qira'at, some of them also narrated ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And here's a quick point that I'll finish with, inshallah, before we talk about Imam Ibn Amir from the book. Last point I'm going to mention here, which is some teachers of the Quran, I want to write this point before I forget it, so that inshallah when تعلم وتعليم وعليم القرآن بعلوم عديدة. Some people and some Quran teachers themselves, they just learn the Quran and they don't worry, they don't learn hadith, they don't learn faqh, they don't learn aqidah, and they just sit and they just teach Quran. That's not right. The very, very least is you have to learn the basic foundations of each ilm, of each science, in aqidah, in faqh, in the Muslim theology or creed, in the jurisprudence, in tasawwuf or tarbiyah or tazkiyah, the spiritual purification, those main sciences of Islam, you should, that any hafiz, any student of the Quran, a hafiz or a teacher of the Quran must learn these basics, because the students of Quran will ask you, they will, you will come across issues, etc. You have to learn those basics. So the Quran teachers should have basic knowledge in hadith, in fiqh, in tafsir, in jurisprudence, in aqidah, and should seek to expand their knowledge in the other sciences, and not allow others to just exclude them or to make them only just like you're a Quran teacher, you just stay, you and then we find people who are not able to recite an ayah. Wallahi, it's heartbreaking, especially here in our area. You see so many khutbah, so many people who come and give the Friday khutbah, their fatiha is not valid. Their fatiha is not valid. They read an ayah in the minbar, in their khutbah, they're not reading the ayah properly. So the Quran teachers and the Quran reciters and the huffaz, they have more, they are the ones who should learn the other Islamic disciplines, and they are the ones who should lead the salah and teach people, and not someone who did not even learn how to read an ayah. That's very important. And we urge those people and those khutaba and those brothers who were given this chance to give a khutbah to go and learn at least the very least the Fatiha correctly and some surah of the Quran correctly so that salah is valid. وَإِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who listen to the speech and follow its best. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us and help us to recite the Quran in the way that pleases Him and act upon it and understand it and teach it to others. وصلي اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Inshallah, we're going to talk about Imam Ibn Amir and his two narrators, Imam Hisham and Ibn Dakwan. Brief things about their lives, and then we're going to start the usul and the foundations of this qira'ah. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Any question about anything we mentioned today? Any question about anything? Okay, alhamdulillah. Any things, inshallah, were clear. And we'll see you, inshallah, next week. Jazakum Allah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.